no half measures. Sometimes all it takes is a cigarette-smoking man to expose the truth. I thought with this one, I'd borrow the greatest series that Jim ever did in order to present this. Internet Insanity for One Night Only is back, and I hope you enjoy what we put together.
At this point, I mean, whatever I seem to cover seems to become the next big thing on his website. You know, you've got Internet Famous now out of New Project 2, the Gunt Sub Forum out of My Crusade Against Ralph, now the Catboy Forum. So I don't know, Josh should be thankful to me for helping him out. I mean, sure, I butt-fucked him and screwed him out of $2,000 a month, and he did fucking nothing at the time, but seethed resentfully about it, and then finally today come out with his attacks. But it is what it is, Josh. I've helped you out now. I've set up your whole site for you, your forums for you, and everything, buddy. I don't know what the fucking issue is.
Were you trying to get crazy with this, eh? Don't you know I'm loco?
I'm not insane! This is not reality! Not reality! Not reality!
This is reality.
When we wish to predict the future, what a man will do next, we only have to look at what he's already done. It was Dave Nordahl, the Lord of Patriarchy, WarCorp 666, who said that. A man who has remained resolute in his devotion to staying the same, being an unchanging force in this ever-changing world.
All right, if you don't know, you should know. My name is WarCorp 666, and I'm the beer-drinking, rant-spewing motherfucker here on YouTube. I don't write scripts for none of my shit. I just shoot from the hip and what I really think and what I really feel, and I really don't give a rat's ass whether you like it or not.
WarCorp 666, for the past 10 years, has come home from his 9-to-5, cracked open a beer, turned on his webcam, and delivered rants about feminism. Anita Sarkeesian, Zoe Quinn, Trigglypuff, he has spewed countless promos on them all, from the perspective of a middle-aged alcoholic wearing a Yoshi t-shirt.
Once again, old War Corps has to make an apology. This time, it's Feminist Frequency. Feminist Frequency, Anita Sarkeesian, the old War Corps is sorry. Sorry about the fact that you're so full of shit!
And in all this time, he has never wavered. He has never sold out or lost his passion or chased the numbers. He has remained true to himself and true to the ethos that brought him to this wonderful place known as the Internet.
Yeah, you read that video title right. Yes, I'm a white nationalist, but I'm not a racist.
In his mind, Gamergate never died. Not really, not for him, anyway. You see, for WarCorp 666, it was never about selling mugs and hats. It was never about super chats and paywalls. It was about bizarrely, or perhaps even admirably. It was about, and still is about, ethics in video games journalism. This is the story of the Kino Casino, how it rose and how it fell.
Oh, fuck. Oh, my God. Okay.
Jesse, I'm sorry. I will never, ever do a show with you. I'm sorry.
You've already done a show with me multiple times.
I will never, ever do a show with you ever again. That's it.
Is that like the way you'll never
Cut off. Well, no,
is that
I am
like
grifting.
The way that you would never
I am grifting, Jesse, but at the end of the day...
What? I'm just talking.
I'll be honest, Andy, like, Jesse can go or I can go at this point. I really don't want to deal with Jesse. You're kicked from the show.
All right. Well,
I'll be for real.
But we can have differences of opinion and we can keep moving on, right? Are we good?
Are we good, Andy?
A long time ago, in a distant land, PPP and I used to make content together. It was a friendship that was first and foremost a creative one. We shared the same mind on pointing out the hypocrisy of retards on the internet. Whether it was Sargon trying to be the voice of the working class but belittling anyone who didn't wear an ill-fitting suit, whether it was Ethan Ralph making a career from pointing and laughing at people but being unable to take a bit of heat when that infamous sack of grizzled flesh made its first appearance, whether it was Nick Fuentes professing to be the next president of the United States but T-posing on teenage girls in a shopping mall. Hypocrisy, ladies and gentlemen, hypocrisy being called out in all its forms.
Chat's going crazy. They want to hear from us, but they don't get to.
Nassim. CBFK.
Leo says total depravity.
Ah!
Oh, shit. What's up?
PPP's bleeding.
Violence.
Let's talk about Dick Masterson, Josh Moon, and New Project 2.
When you're raped by a pack of...
The reality of it is, why is everybody from New Project 2 defending you?
Dick Masterson of Dr. Phil fame had entered the IBS scene and decided to create a Patreon alternative after some creators had been banned from the platform. This was in keeping with Masterson's free speech, zero censorship, anything goes code of ethics. The Patreon alternative he set up was called New Project 2. And a few creators in the sector joined the site. Jim, Josh, Gator, Ralph, and a litany of other characters that we all know and love. But as time rolled on, there were a few things about New Project 2 that raised questions. Like, why hadn't any effort gone into the website itself? Why had no attention been spent on its terms of service? Why did it seem that only friends of Dick Masterson could join the site? New Project 2 was fertile ground for someone to come along and start building their name on getting to the truth of the matter. It was PPP who stepped up to that plate. He famously got onto a stream with Dick Masterson and rose to prominence. He got a lot of people to listen to his message, and soon more and more questions were being asked about New Project 2. Like, why were people being asked for their social security numbers in order to be on the website? Who was handling the information? Were people's personal and financial details being compromised? Question after question after question mounted up, and the pressure was on Dick Masterson to start providing answers. But the answers that came seemed opaque and not direct. They didn't explain things in a way that reassured people. And instead of addressing the noise about New Project 2 head-on, Masterson decided to antagonize a forum of users where the majority of these questions were being asked. He decided to wage war on the Kiwi Farms, or as he would now call it, the Karen Farms. Now, in that stream where PPP and Dick Masterson met on the battlefield, Masterson's claims were that he was more successful, better looking, had a higher viewership than PPP. He said that he was the prom king and living in a mansion in the Hollywood Hills.
So look, it is obvious that Dick, for legal reasons, has to have everybody's social security numbers, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so you admit you have access to people's social security numbers.
I'm pretty sure I got a 1099 from New Project 2.
Yeah, you got a 1099.
Okay. Yeah.
Wait, let him talk.
What are you interrupting me for?
What have you ever done in your life? I'm a fucking...
Oh, I know. What have you done? You've been
here.
On Dr. Phil in a Pizza Hut commercial.
But he's telling you that the data isn't on his...
Do you know what I've done, Dick? Do you know what I've done in my life? I've saved souls.
You know me,
Jesus Christ. Have you ever...
Do it! Do it in Peter Griffin voice, please!
But he couldn't even fucking make it.
Go ahead. Tell me what you have. What do you know about
me? I couldn't even make it. I live in a Barbie's dream mansion in a hill.
No, that's all that matters.
You Canadian prick. Yeah, it is all that matters because I go out of here, I fuck my girlfriend in a fucking mansion. Meanwhile, you and whoever you have in the background, your fucking hype man, stick your thumbs up each other's asses and jerk each other off, telling you what a great job you did. It does fucking matter.
You're a real cool dude, Dick.
It was desperate one-upmanship. They didn't go down well with his audience and actually had the opposite effect of turning more people to PPP's side. Users on Kiwi Farms even fact-checked Masterson's boasts and discovered that the Barbie Dream Mansion in the Hollywood Hills was, in reality, this. A crack shack on the outskirts of Compton. The rising tide was against Masterson, as it had been conclusively revealed that the Emperor had no clothes. Josh Null, the owner and operator of the Kiwi Farms, seemed initially to resist the rising tide of users who'd had enough of Masterson's shenanigans. He defended Masterson's description of his home as a mansion. People were confused by this. They wondered why Josh would behave this way. The explanation given was that Masterson was Josh's friend, which is fair enough. But what is friendship if you can't laugh when one of you is being a retard?
What about Dick? He's an alcoholic. I'm like, well, I guess you got me there. I don't know what to think. I'm not someone who will cut someone off. In a way like Dick. Dick will probably never disavow Ethan Ralph. You know, he didn't disavow Digibro. He didn't disavow anyone. But I'm reluctant to say like, oh, I just want nothing to do with Dick.
People started to look deeper into the Josh Masterson connection in order to try and explain the motive for why things were being swept up. It came to light that Josh was one of the highest earners on New Project 2, and it was netting him just shy of $2,000 a month. It was clear that there was some sort of conflict of interest. Eventually, a man called Vordrak performed some dark arts, magic, sacrificed a baby, killed a goat, drank its blood, and New Project 2 was deplatformed from its payment processor, and the saga came to an ignominious end. But the legacy of the Ark was that PPP, the man who started the fire, cost Josh $2,000 a month by leading a crusade against the website that was paying him. PPP, the righteous anti-grifter who wasn't compromised by being in the pocket of Dick Masterson, mounted his charge against a scummy website that seemed like a scam and didn't explain to the public who was handling people's private, personal, financial details, how it was being handled, and whether or not a list of users was being kept in order to be potentially exchanged to illicit forces for money.
Wahoo!
Is it a good day, buddy?
Everybody dab on his fucking grave!
But anyway, that was New Project 2. Ancient history. A footnote in the long tapestry of internet spurgery. Something that should have been forgotten, lost to the mists of time. Alas, even the best laid plans of mice and men go awry.
They want me because I'm the hottest property in this sphere right now.
In the aftermath of New Project 2, PPP's star rose and rose, and his viewership exponentially grew. The audience sided with PPP, the underdog, making his name on taking down the big dog grifters in the sector. PPP wasn't bragging about the numbers or the money or his prom king status. Instead, he was the everyman. He didn't give a damn. He just said what was on his mind and didn't need fancy OBS templates to make his points. The effectiveness of PPP was that he could fire up a stream on his mobile phone and deliver a fire and brimstone sermon on the state of the nation and the sinners within it.
It's time. It's time to talk about one of the biggest scam artists that there's ever been. So, we're talking about Wilshire Boulevard. Now, what the hell is Wilshire Boulevard? Well, Wilshire Boulevard is a book that Coach supposedly wrote, that Gonzalo Lira supposedly wrote. It was already written, guys, and he just needed a little bit of support to get the book over the top. Spoiler alert, the book still isn't out. How could that be? He said it was already written. How could it not be out? But anyway, getting ahead of ourselves here. Wilshire Boulevard, a novel. He's raised $14,288 Canadian dollars out of his $9,986 flexible goal, so that the project was funded.
And people liked him because he didn't have an ego. He didn't have this involvement. He had this detachment. And the internet was a hobby and not a career for him. That was the most important thing.
Jarbo came on and just fucking unleashed and just punked that fucking bitch-ass pussy Ethan Ralph. Ethan Ralph wouldn't debate him one-on-one. Ethan Ralph wouldn't go on his show, a neutral platform, or Kato's show. It had to be the Kato stream, where Gator plays the soundboard and cranks your volume down to negative 20. Well, mine's at 5,000. Well, the reality is Jarbo fucking knocked you out. So you have to fucking cry and complain about it because you're the new prison prag that gets fucking raped.
He was just a guy having fun, laughing at hypocrites on the internet. It wasn't a grift. It wasn't about super chats or donations. It was about content, first and foremost. The integrity of putting on a good, entertaining show. For many, including myself, this was the golden age.
Fuck Phantom Organization's furry Discord. Fuck him, he's a pedophile. I don't care. That's what I said. Fuck every one of these cocksuckers, these degenerates and faggots who try and leech off of me, I guess.
However, nothing lasts forever, and all good things must come to an end. Often, the indication that the good times are over and entropy has kicked in comes in the embodiment of this man, Andy Worski. A man who has never changed his spots, who has never cared about whether his contribution is of quality, who seemingly has never held any conviction on any issue beyond whether or not it will make him money. And you know what? With someone like Worski, that's okay, because he's never claimed to be anything different. He never started against grifters and became one himself, no. He has always been an unapologetic, child-aborting, grifting retard, from start to finish.
Well, I am the man. And you're going to show me this level of disrespect on fucking camera?
Buddy, don't be a fucking hero. Buddy, don't be a fucking hero.
Don't
be a fucking man.
No, you don't be a fucking hero, buddy.
Are you fucking being serious? What do you think's going to happen?
What, are you going to try to fight me?
What are you doing?
When I take care of
you? What are
you
talking about, buddy? Like, what fucking world are you living in?
A series of circumstances and happenings led to PPP and Andy Worski joining forces and creating a primetime internet blood sports show called the Kino Casino.
It's the new golden age. PPP and Worski present
Fantastic!
The Kino Casino.
Don't stay back, but come in and make sure you aim for the top prize here at the Kino Casino.
The casino at first seemed to be a hybrid of the two men's approaches on the internet, a cross between Worski's shameless grifting motifs, hence the casino theme, and PPP's topics of pointing out the hypocrisy of his two most studied topics, Ethan Ralph and Nick Fuentes. The show started with a lot of goodwill behind it. People were happy that PPP, the underdog, now had some success in getting his anti-Ralph, anti-Fuentes message out there to tens of thousands of people, more viewers than he'd had ever before.
Look at this! I thought we felt it. Back and bigger than ever, the Ralph of Males winning, Andy. What are we
gonna do? And people were happy that Worski was able to escape from the shadow of his years-long alliance with Ethan Ralph and get back to the heady heights of the JF Worski Live days of yore. Because of this goodwill, the Super Chats were flowing in. Money was being made. The two had successfully managed to monetize the PPP talking points on Fuentes and Ralph and proven that there was a gap in the market to do so. But one of the big questions that entered my mind right from the beginning was this. Why is this thing called Power Chat being promoted by the Kino Casino as the primary way of donating to them. Why didn't they promote something else, more credible, stream elements, or hell, even enable YouTube's own super chatting facility? It was very strange to me that the Power Chat was primarily the platform where donations were being asked to be sent to. So I looked into Power Chat, and I discovered that Power Chat was a payment processor for IP2 and is and always has been linked to people like Lulz, Baked Alaska, Nick Fuentes, America First. It's murky. It's really, really seedy and always has been. Even from before episode 1 of the Kino Casino, PPP was warned not to use Power Chat because of these questions. All of us knew that this would come back to haunt you.
It's a Godwinson Live news alert!
Right, so let's get into this. Let's fucking do this. So, Power Chat is the primary way that PPP and Worski get their super chats. Now, this is a fucking suspicious, sketchy-ass motherfucking site. This is shady as fuck. It definitely looks like something, and probably is something, probably definitely 100% is something, that harvests your personal details. So, why didn't Worski and PPP stop using Power Chat when they were told to? Why didn't they stop? Instead, they doubled down. It was suspicious as fuck, ladies and gentlemen. And now it turns out, folks, that Power Chat is 50% owned by Baked Alaska. Baked fucking Alaska. You can't write this shit, folks. Baked Alaska, a known federal informant, owns a 50% share in Power Chat. So PPP and Worski have knowingly used a federal informant's website to host their super chats. They knew all along. Now, this is a website that harvests incredibly significant amounts of personal data, your credit card details, your address, your phone number, your name. It needs and takes everything from you in order to sell it on to the highest bidder. You've all been sold out, folks.
There it is. There it is.
So funny to me.
The fucking beaver.
Yep.
Yep, Paul. Are you okay?
Yep.
You drunk?
Yep.
Okay. How about going to bed? Do you want me to help you?
Yep.
Anyway, the goodwill was still with the Kino Casino. The Fuck Ralph Festival united Ralph's enemies under one banner. And Jim interviewing Jaden McNeil made the casino the number one place for criticism of Nick Fuentes and America First. People were willing to overlook the flaws that were apparent and rationalizing in their own minds that these things will be ironed out with the passage of time and as more shows are made. Things like Worski pausing any given clip every 5 seconds to give some of the most wet brain takes in the history of mankind. Things like the show only ever being about the two topics of Ralph and Fuentes. Things like Worski forcibly interrupting PPP's flow in order to stutter his way through a screed of super chats. These things would be ironed out, surely, and the show would find its groove and evolve and develop into something truly amazing.
PPP, please ask Andy to uninstall the space bar on his keyboard. You should be the holder of the pause. Andy said the show fell apart without him. Silence him. Whoa, buddy. That's fucking some intense shit there. I don't know. Sometimes I sympathize with the sentiment, brother. Sometimes I'm like, I want to get through this fucking clip, man. Sometimes I just want to get through the clips, man, but it's stuff.
Relish head. For $20.
But week after week, show after show, it all came and went with zero improvement. The topics remained the same, the delivery remained the same, the retardation got worse, and things turned truly stagnant and stale. A And even when the topics looked like they would change from flogging the dead horses of Ethan Ralph and Nick Fuentes, the change appeared to be in the form of Worski shilling an Instagram account where he, a man in his mid-30s who snorts cocaine from the picture frames in his parents' living room, pretends to be the next up-and-coming featherweight champion of the world. It's desperate. It's garbage. It's shit. Straight up.
Right.
Cog, my man. Let's go, champ.
That is Cog.
Other Cog.
He'll be here. There goes. Oh, wait, real fast. Oh, real fast. Medicare Masochist for $50 saying Ethan Ralph is an inspiration. Every time I see him, I immediately have to get on the treadmill. Thank you so much, Medicare Masochist, for the 50.
And so the inevitable happened, and people's goodwill for the casino began to dry up. They'd had enough of seeing the same old, week after week, and they'd had enough of offering suggestions every week to improve things, but never being heard. It was the contempt that the Kino Casino had for its audience that proved its downfall. If all you see your audience as is a paycheck, and you don't value and respect their opinions, then you truly have sealed your fate. The aspiration shouldn't be to shamelessly grift a dollar without putting any effort into the content whatsoever. The content, the show, the creative process should always be front and center, just like in the good old days. Now, full disclosure, I made an appearance on the Kino Casino and was paid upfront £500, which amounts to something like $800 Canadian. I want to explain the reason why I was there and what was going on behind the scenes. I had been contacted by PPP after a long absence from the internet, and I was told that Worski was being fired imminently, and whether or not I would be available to replace him as the permanent co-host. The reason why Worski was being fired was self-evident, really, but it mainly boiled down to Worski going on holiday, not to Portugal with his family, as he lied to the audience about, but instead flying out to see some catfish in the US, on the proviso that he would have sex with her. He didn't. She refused to sleep with Worski, or even kiss him. And Worski, after a full week, flew back to his parents' house and seethed on Discord. When Worski went on this jaunt, PPP put on a series of shows with Persip, the King of Pol, the Squire of Gothos, and Culture War Criminal. The wheels of the show kept turning, even though Worski was away, and the money was secured. We fast forward to a month or so later, where PPP is unable to make a couple of Kino Casino episodes. And instead of Worski putting on the show in PPP's absence, instead of him putting on a good show or even a show and delivering to the audience, there was no show. Worski didn't lift a finger. In fact, he never does. The reality of how the Kino Casino is made and put together is that Persip and the Squire sit there all week prepping the show, gathering clips and notes. It is then briefed to PPP extensively in multi-hour long calls. The show is seemingly locked down, and then literally 30 minutes before the show goes live on a Friday night, PPP tells Worski what the show is about, and Worski puts in absolutely zero effort into the show prep whatsoever. He turns up every week and expects that PPP has prepared the show for him to grift off of. And Worski, believe it or not, has the right to veto anything he doesn't like on the show. Like some sort of shit king. And if PPP doesn't do the preparation because either he's on holiday or ill, then the show doesn't get made. Worski then gets 50% of all the money made for his retarded laughter, his inability to speak, and his cringeworthy Instagram shilling. Woo, lad.
Cockroach. Worski, you're just a fucking cockroach, buddy. Like, okay, like, fuck you. Like, what was he just saying?
That looked like diarrhea. Like.
Ethan's made of stronger stuff than you or I.
What does that mean? What does that mean?
We're like one slot. Stop. Get up.
No, dude, I'm not leaving yet.
Gorski, Keynes, and Meyer. Fuck, he's laughing right now at you, probably.
Yeah.
So yeah, PPP explained to me that because of this behavior, Worski was being fired imminently. And I agreed to come aboard and right the ship. I had many discussions with PPP where we hammered out the new direction of the show. We were going to pivot away from Ralph and Fuentes and start a crusade against BreadTube and Vouch and plow a new, fertile, creative furrow. We were going to do two shows a week and do away with the Wednesday rape back show. The casino was still going to be on a Friday, but the Saturday was going to be a new show where there were going to be blood sports debates of old, where two retards would scream at each other, just like in the golden age. The paywalled content, the Gumroad content, was actually going to have effort put into it. No longer would the audience be disrespected by having to pay for 90-day fiancé reviews. Instead, the content was going to be edited videos like this one you're watching right here, and PPP solo videos, ranting like he used to back in the day. Worski wasn't fired, and it became apparent to me that PPP wasn't in the position of being able to dethrone Worski. It turns out that the Kino Casino was Worski's show. He had always been the one in control. And whether or not PPP likes it, he is unable to get rid of Worski. PPP had signed a pact with the devil and willingly relegated himself to the category of Geek Thulu, Alex, and Kyla. Sorry, guys. I gave you a taste of what could have been, but now it will never be.
Yeah, and that guy got arrested.
Yeah, but what if he shot?
Yeah. I'd get more super chats, more money.
Yeah.
That's fucked. That's sick. That's his mindset even now. That's what his mindset is even now. If those men got shot and those men died and Alex went to prison for the rest of his life, at least I would have got more super chats. At least I would have got more money. That's his mentality. And that's what's dangerous about the fucking grifters and these pieces of fucking shit. That is a human piece of fucking shit. He learned absolutely nothing from this experience. If they had died, I would have made more money. That's all that matters to him. He doesn't give a fuck about human lives. He doesn't give a fuck at all about anybody going to jail, anybody dying. All he cares about is lining his own pockets. And this was a year and a half later, and he didn't know. He was so retarded that he thought that that was a good answer and that that would win him praise with his hero. What filth. Like, that is honestly one of the most disgusting fucking comments. Look, I'm no pussy. I'm no bitch, you know? I say a lot of shit that's really politically incorrect and fucked up. But that shit is really fucked. That is legitimately saying that he doesn't give a fuck who lives or dies as long as he gets paid. Well, you know what, man? Why don't you suck my fucking cock, you fucking retarded mongoloid. You retarded cokehead. You degenerate. You filth. I honestly, if I could, I would put a bullet in that motherfucker's head.
Now let's turn our attention back to the power chat, to Josh Moon, a man who rightly deserves some sort of retribution after PPP led a crusade against the new Project 2 website, which was paying him just shy of $2,000 a month. Josh Moon comes along and starts asking questions. He starts applying the same standards that were applied against him to the Kino Casino.
Look, even now, you see people like Perspericity come in and say, is that why you declared Dax's house to be a mansion? I said that it was an expensive house because it was in the Hollywood Hills, and it is an expensive house. I would not mind having the money of that house to put towards my own house, not in fucking L.A. I did not say it was a mansion. If I did say it was a mansion, it was just to piss people off. What was annoying was having people coming over to be irate about this bullshit, which amounted to nothing because it was nothing. And you can still see the remnants of these people who are blindsided by this bullshit trying to hold me accountable for it when there is nothing that has ever happened. Meanwhile, the person who puts out this information immediately does a 180 on everything that he's ever stood for, starts soliciting donations to the tunes of tens of thousands of dollars, and uses a power chat system built by the people that he is openly ridiculing, giving full incentive for those people to download and store and keep for blackmail or for cross-referencing later the payment details of his supporters.
There is such a thing as karmic retribution, as poetic justice, and it seems to me that we are now in a situation where PPP and Worski have fallen victim to their very own new project too, where the personal, financial, private information of their donators are incredibly compromised.
The hypocrisy bothers me a lot. Because it was, both times that I've dealt with PPP, it was a fucking mess. Like, the people that think he is some sort of, like, paragon of virtue, and who knows how to hold content creators to some standard that he defines to better the internet, only for him to betray all of that, and just start ripping off his retard fans for fucking money, using tools that people he does not like, and actively defames, to get that money, is beyond the pale to me.
Are all of the donators on a list waiting to be doxxed by Nick Fuentes? Will the list instead be handed to the state? Who is handling this information? Why were PPP and Worski promoting the power chat first and foremost above all the other tip jars? Something here stinks. It really stinks rotten. And people are waking up and seeing that hypocrisy is hypocrisy, regardless of whether or not they have the same enemies in common. Just because Ralph is a retard, it doesn't give you license to behave the same way, if not worse, and get away with it. It doesn't give you the license to sell your audience's personal details, their addresses, their bank account details, to nefarious forces. People have had enough. They have had enough of any criticism being aimed at the casino being deflected with a point and look. Hey, look at what Ethan Ralph and Nick Fuentes are doing today. Enough is enough. It's time to take some accountability, because another man's crimes do not excuse your own. Now, Josh's public exposing of the Kino Casino Power Chat being a weird sort of fed honeypot and all of the Kino Casino's donators being compromised led to this explanation from the show itself.
What?
All right. I do have an announcement to make before we go any further into the show. It's with a heavy heart that I have to announce that myself and Andy are working for CSIS. We are actually federal agents.
Yep.
We took a plea deal for hate speech charge. We turned all your names over, all your payment details over to the federal government. You're all going to jail. I'm sorry. It rules
we
being
glow.
In the Fed gang. Nick Fuentes, Baked Alaska, our homies. We all got rich together, bro. Make it rain. Make it holla. It's just, but in all seriousness, there's been a lot of, I don't know what you want to say, bullshit in the air about PowerChat, a lot of speculation, so to speak, about PowerChat. I just briefly wanted to explain to people what PowerChat is, like how it was started, why we were using it, and how it actually fucking works, so people understand. So when PowerChat was first created, it was called Lules.tips, and it was created by an alcoholic named Lules, that's an IP2 streamer. So we kept using the the service because there's no risk anymore.
No risk. And,
let's explain how it actually works. So far as Baked Alaska owning a portion of it, that's not true. But I will say this, Nick Fuentes, and the reason we're not going to use it going forward, is attempting, and this is what's been happening, is he's attempting to extort everybody who's using it for 25% of the profits, which is fucking insane. What he did to Lules earlier this week was he called Lules up and was like, well, you see, a lot of the people using it are cozy streamers, so if you don't start charging them 25% to use the service and kick it to me, I'm going to have all the cozy streamers stop using the payment platform.
It stinks. It stinks of a cover-up, of answers not being properly given, of a proper account not being respectfully provided towards the audience and the people that pay you. It is the same sweeping up Janny-esque behavior that Dick Masterson performed when he was trying to bury the new Project 2 scandal. Even to deflect away from the criticisms and wage war on Kiwi farms, it's the same playbook. The playbook of desperate men who have been found out.
And I think Josh should thank me for that. At this point, I mean, whatever I seem to cover seems to become the next big thing on his website. You know, you've got Internet Famous now out of New Project 2, the Gunt Sub Forum out of My Crusade Against Ralph, now the Catboy Forum. So I don't know, Josh should be thankful to me for helping him out. I mean, sure, I butt-fucked him and screwed him out of $2,000 a month, and he did fucking nothing at the time, but seethed resentfully about it, and then finally today come out with his attacks. But, it is what it is, Josh. I've helped you out now. I've set up your whole site for you, your forums for you, and everything, buddy. I don't know what the fucking issue is, but he's still seething about New Project 2 to this fucking day. And this is what it ultimately boils down to, is that Josh is upset and jealous that there's somebody out there that has the charisma and the persuasion skills influence the users of his site to make them believe things.
Even for the casino to deflect away from its power chat scandal by trying to resurrect the New Project 2 scandal is even more shameful.
So this is Dick Masterson, for those of you who've seen on screen, making an announcement that New Project 2 is going to return. He's coming up with a new payment processing alternative. Now, what I find interesting is a week or two on this show, we played a clip of Dick Masterson making overtures to Josh that he misses him, that he loves him.
Oh, yeah.
And this is, and now let's also point out that this tweet was liked and retweeted by Nick Fuentes' Twitter account, The Minion 2000.
Oh.
So it seems to me that Josh would probably like to be involved with this new version of New Project 2. So he's coming on this attack so that he can now be a part of New Project 3.
And despite all of this, perhaps what's even more startling is this confession.
But we're going to preemptively end our relationship with PowerChat, since now Nick is apparently going to be involved. But what timing, Ashton? We have some bros, some homies, creating our own version of PowerChat that you log in using the piggyback off Google the same way. And am I allowed to announce the other thing? Like, even
no,
if like,
no, don't say anything just yet. But there are large developments coming in
massive,
the pipeline.
Massive developments.
So PPP and Worski are building their own payment processor? Bro, can we not? The circle is complete. The oppressed has become the oppressor. My dear sweet PPP, he has become everything he used to profess to be against. He'll be bragging about his Barbie dream mansion before the week's out, I'm sure. It used to be about the Music Man. You were my hero, and now you've changed.
And again, a large part of this too is jealousy from Josh over the fact that we're able to have, you know, a large amount of donations come in. We're getting, starting to surpass him in viewership.
Yeah.
So this is what's going on, folks. And not only that, but that's just the tip of the iceberg.
I mean, he cried. He was crying. I heard a clip where he was crying about me. He's like, how come Ashton works with Andy? It's like, Ashton can use OBS. I'm like, I don't know, maybe Ashton likes working with me. Like, you think about that? Like, maybe I'm like, it's good times. Our Gum Road, we have a fucking blast over there. Like, we have a great fucking time on this show. And he's like, why is Ashton? Because we're co-hosts with each other. Ashton, he's the king of fucking the rant. I'm the king of keeping this all afloat. Remember when I left for 1 week, what happened? The show almost tanked.
Alas, poor PPP, I knew him well. But I think it's time, don't you?